Hi everyone, thanks for joining me. In today's video, I'm going to be doing a breakdown of a famous Australian artist's solo that I did a cover for a few months ago. So the song was by John Farnham. It was called Let Me Out, and the guitarists that wrote and recorded the solo was none other than the absolutely amazing genius Brett Garsed, one of Australia's own truly unique talents. There's no one quite like him, in my opinion. Anyway, thanks for Tim Simons for requesting the breakdown. I had to admit, I had to go back and learn it. It took me a couple of hours to get my head back around it. But I suppose in doing so, I kind of looked at it again and what I did originally, and I modified and improved a couple of things that weren't quite as smooth as they probably should have been, and probably weren't in the same kind of vein as Brett maybe would have approached it in the original solo. Now, I used programs to isolate the guitar track and slow everything down to like a ridiculously slow level, and so I could try and hear everything, all the little nuances where I could hear a definite pick, where I could hear a slide or a hammer on a pull off. And Brett is obviously he's a genius hybrid picker. I can't hybrid pick like Brett, so I did my best to come up with a way to do it that suited my way of playing. So this is by no means how Brett played it. Brett, if you could show us how you did it, that would be fantastic. If you see this video, this is just my interpretation of it. This is how I think most guitarists might get around playing it, if you don't have the capacity to use all your fingers like Brett does with his hybrid picking. I mean, he just doesn't use hybrid picking with, you know, his middle finger there as well. He uses his little pinky as well. He's very dexterous in that regard. Very honed skill he has. Anyway, so what I'd like to do in this video is I'm gonna show you my original version, cover that I did. I'm going to play Brett's with the full backing track, and then I'm going to play you the isolated track as well. I'm not going to replay the whole solo at speed. I do want to perhaps have a look at the original tone that I used for the Spark amp as well. It might help you get a little bit closer to achieving that sound. And again, it's only an approximation. Anyway, so first things first, let's have a listen to the original John Farnham track. Not in its entirety, just the solo section. And then I'll explain what's going on afterwards, and we'll do a breakdown section by section. All right, here's the first part. How wicked was that? Okay, so let's play the actual isolated Brett Garsed track for you all now. Here it comes.
Thank you.
Let's have a look at mine now. Let's get on with the lesson side of things. So the first thing I want to do is talk about the key structure. So coming out of the chorus, or the chorus kind of ends on B major. It ends on the fifth chord of B major, which is F sharp. Let me out. Mind my singing. Anyway, and from there it modulates again. The key, we have key change for the solo. There's three mode changes, two modes in the same key and one mode in its own key and in a separate key. What we're looking at here, first of all, is, and this is what the structure of the solo kind of sounds like. I'll just give you a quick demonstration. It's so what we've got first is the D major chord, and that's going to be D Lydian, which is the four chord of A major. And then that modulates to E Mixolydian, but we're still staying in the key of A major. So that's the fifth mode of A major. And then we modulate to B Mixolydian. And so what those individual scales sound like is this. That's the D, and here's the E. And here's the B Mixolydian. Okay, and the reason why it's handy to know those and get your head around those patterns and explore the fretboard of all the positions where those modes and scales are played is because if you find that you're getting lost, I don't know if I mentioned, just quickly I'll go back, B Mixolydian happens to be the fifth mode of E major. So you're going between the two keys, A major and E major. Sorry, let me go back. So the reason why we want to know what the chords are and the modes to play over them is because if we get lost, it helps to know the patterns that we need to be using, the shapes and notes, so that we can find our way back without making too many noticeable mistakes or do our own improvising over the top of it should we get lost. That's what these guys are masters at. Brett is an absolute master improviser. He's definitely a rare breed in that regard. He's spent his life honing his craft, and he's been able to do it for a very long, long time. I mean, you can see it when he does his Let Me Out live solo on John Farnham early in the early 90s after the song was released. It's incredible. The live one is just as impressive as the studio version. Anyway, it helps to know the modes. And so explore your fretboard, know where you are, where you're going, where you need to be. Be aware of the chord changes around you. Okay, so now that we've got the modes and the keys out of the way and the chords out of the way, let's look at breaking down the solo section by section. Okay, so let's start with the first section of the solo. That's the natural harmonics. The first one we want to start off is the third fret above the B string. Kind of start off with a bit of a dive, and it sounds like this. And then immediately after that, we're going to play the harmonic above that same fret on the third fret on the G string this time. So So I'm trying not to play with too much gain, so there's not too much noise in the background. So now we're going to move on to the first part of the solo, the first phrase, and that sounds like this. All right, so that's that first phrase. Now we've got the next bit. What I tend to do is from there. So I'll do a bit of a slide up and make sure I hit it with my third finger. Again. All right, and then from there, slide up. So sliding down to the seventh fret on the G string. Now what I'm going to do here is slide back up to the ninth fret. So what we've got so far is this. Right, and the reason why I've stopped there is because the next section is complicated and requires the use of Brett's famous hybrid picking. And so that sounds like this very slowly. And I'll try not to play it with too much gain so it's a bit clearer. So from, we go. All right, we'll do that again. So. So we're going. And you'll notice I'm using my middle finger there, picking, and then my middle finger, then pick that bass note again. All right, and then we go to the next part of that fast passage from. So it's the same pattern, but a different set of strings and a different part of that scale. So. And then from that section there, that fast phrase, we go to, we stay in that same position there. So. Let me do that again for you. All right, so this part here, we'll explain to that, and we'll do it slowly again for you. So once we get to this part up here, all right, again, we're using that same technique. Pick with our pick, and then our middle finger to hit the B string. And then we're going to do a hammer on and pull off. So you can keep your fingers in that one position there, not move them too much. Obviously, what a lot of these guys do to get so fast and so fluid, it's all about economy of motion. You don't want to use or move your fingers too far around. So find the quickest, most efficient way to get from point A to B. And this is what I like to emphasize when I'm trying to show anybody anything on the guitar. Usually the easiest way is the correct way or the right way. Not saying that it's always going to be the case, but try to minimize your movement. That's all I'm saying. So let's go back to that section. Okay, so from there we're going. All right, let me do that again for you. So. And I like to hit that. You don't have to hit that open note. You could hit the with your pinky, and then you can do a hybrid pick. But I actually find that I like the way that it feels as much as anything. Going... Oh, sorry. And then I can just hammer on that. I don't have to actually pick it again. So... Okay, so let me play that whole section really slowly again for you. So we've got, this is what it looks like. So I won't worry about the harmonics again. So we've got... Okay, so that's the first hard part out of the way. It only gets worse from here. So this is one of my favorite parts, actually. And Brett's actually really great at incorporating the way that he picks as well. It's unique to him. He likes to do some natural, well, sort of pinch harmonics as he plays to bring out certain overtones in his notes, and that's going to be prevalent in the next, some of the sections coming up. Also, like tapped harmonics as well, which is the next section. Anyway, we'll get onto those pinched harmonics in a second. So the next section sounds like this. Let's find out where we finished off. All right, this is where we start with our tapping harmonics. So. Now, again, you have to be really accurate. And again, it's a bit hit and miss, but you have to be very specific. It doesn't help to have this ridiculously low action on this guitar. It's really hard to get those tapped harmonics. So slightly higher action is going to be able to get you those pinched, so tapped harmonics a bit easier. So this is what we're going for again. On the 14th fret, 12th fret, 11th fret, back to the 12th. So I'll do that phrase again for you. Sorry, I'm going over. I'm just trying to demonstrate that that's what the pattern sounds like. All right, and then we move up because it's a modal change. Let me do that again for you. So now we're on the 9 and 11, 9 fret and 9 and 11. Right, so together it sounds like this. All right, cool. So next section sounds like this. So you hear what I mean when I say those pinched harmonics just add some extra overtones. You kind of get the original note in there as well. It's not like a really hard screaming harmonic. They're just like a really gentle pinch harmonic. If you can hit them, it just makes it extra tasty, the solo. All right, so after that, we go to the really fast section. And this is a signature Brett Garsed at his finest in his legato and hybrid techniques. And so we want to do is I'll play it really, really slowly for you. I'm not going to play it like ridiculously fast. You saw me play it like that in the original video. So this is the way that I approach this section. It sounds like this. Do that again for you, nice and slowly. Okay, so let me see if I can do that section by section and be a bit more clear about where I'm picking and where I'm using my middle finger to hybrid pick. And remember, there's a lot of legato in here as well, so you want to be very clean with the... you could use fret wrap. I'm not using it in this instance because I've got my gain down a little bit. So let me just start phrase by phrase. So we got... So whenever I hit the E string, I'm using my middle finger, my hybrid pick. And that's a pull off section. All right, so we're going to the next part. All right, I'll do that again slowly. So we got. In that whole section there, I don't really use my hybrid pick. I do a couple of economy picks in there, but it's mostly just legato. So you're using just the weight of your fingers and hammering on and pulling off to get them. There are a couple of bits there. You could get away with probably not picking any of it, but I like to put a couple of those picks in there because it just helps those notes kind of jump out a bit more, which are predominantly the... let me just go back a sec. Yeah, so you'll notice those small sections in there when I'm, you know, changing to a new string or something like that. Whoops, that I'm adding that pick in there, and also pay attention to where I'm putting the slide and which finger I'm sliding on as well, because that helps with your position change. And so let me do that bit again. So. All right, so you just, yep, watch what I'm doing. Anyway, so from that section there, then we're going and we're going to do a bit of a legato roll up. And this is, again, there is where I'm using my hybrid when I get to the B string. Watch where I'm sliding up from. All right, the next section looks like this. Yep, so we're gonna, and one thing Brett loves to do and is great at doing is adding those passing notes and chromaticism and stuff like that. Anyway, hopefully I did that slowly enough for you to get your head around, Tim, and anyone else that's watching. I hope someone watches it. Anyway, okay, so I think I've covered everything I need to in the solo. Yep, just watch out for... just try and make your legatos nice and separate. I think one thing I wanted to say as well when I was relearning the solo, and actually this section here is one of the positions that I ended up changing the... That bit there I kind of cleaned up a bit. Now I think what I wanted to emphasize was when you're doing that whole phrase there, that the end bit, it kind of has a tempo to it. So there are certain notes you want to hit when certain beats come. Now, it's going to be hard for me to do it without the backing track and really slowly at the moment. But anyway, what I wanted to kind of... Maybe I'll do a bit of a head bob and a bit of a vocalization so you can kind of hear where the beat's supposed to... Where the note's supposed to be with regards to the beat and the tempo. So we got... So if you get what I'm saying, if you can see what my head is doing. Except that little section up the top there, it gets a bit faster. So you kind of have to adjust a little bit. So most of that first section has a fairly consistent tempo. That roll up, that bit there kind of has a little bit of a speed up as well. So you'll have to adjust there. The section here with the chromaticism, again, it's not that same perfect timing as the... Yeah, so just be conscious of the beat. The best thing I can do to the advice I can give you is actually take a snapshot of my isolated version of Brett's. I use an app on my Android, funny enough, which is very handy, called Music Speed Changer. So what I do is I'll use something like RipX, or you can use Moises or whatever it's called. I use RipX, and I'll take the song, I'll record it into GarageBand off YouTube or something like that. Select the section that I want, or the whole song, import it into RipX. It'll isolate the parts for me, and then I can send it to my phone as an MP3, and I can loop and slow things down and just really fine tune and really listen to what's going on in there. I urge you to do the same thing when you're trying to learn anything hard. And modern technology has been great for that. That's probably why we've got all these fantastic Instagram guitarists that do these amazing 30-second videos. Anyway, so that's how I tend to learn things, is to isolate the guitar track, slow it down. It really helps to try and nail the essence of the tone as well. And hopefully I didn't screw up my tone when I left my Spark app. Well, I think I did. No, it's still there. Good. Fantastic. Anyway, so we'll have a look at that in a second. I actually might save that as a new tone. Save as new. 3 amp. What I'll do for everybody that owns a Spark amp is I'm going to share this to the Tone Cloud, and hopefully you can experience something similar. Now I'll explain a couple of things that I've got going on to make it a little bit better, but only marginally. What the tone's going to be called, and I'll share the link to it in the description. It's going to be called Brett Garsed 3. It's the third version I've had. In the original recording, I had I used two Sparks, and I used an external chorus pedal. And the reason why I did that was because I needed to use the EQ pedal in the Spark amp, and you can't use the chorus pedal in the same block as the EQ. So I needed to use the EQ, and I used the chorus pedal and the two Sparks going into a stereo chorus pedal so that I can get a nice stereo chorus, a really rich 80s or late 80s, early 90s thing happening there. But what I've done this time is I've tweaked the Soldano amp that I've used on the app, and the Rat clone pedal in the app as well. And this time I've included the chorus pedal, but I'll show you what else I've got going on in my board down here in a second, or explain it. Anyway, I can't show you. The tone is called Brett Garsed 3, and the link will be in the description. So have fun with that. I'll quickly explain what I've got going here on in the amp block. So I've got obviously I'll explain my signal chain for starters. Don't worry too much about your guitar. I believe Brett, based on the early video of Brett playing it live with John Farnham, I believe he actually used his Strat, which he still loves to do. You see him in his YouTube channel all the time using. It's great sound. He has an immaculate tone. The guy's a tone master. And even though the tone is of the original recording is like this really processed kind of sound that you got from that era, you know, lots of kind of rack effects and delay and chorus and all that sort of stuff, it's still crystal clear. His notes are, they still jump out. It's not washed out. It's fantastic. I really love that kind of processed sound from the 80s and coming out of it. But anyway, here's my signal part. So if you've got single coils, great. If you've got humbuckers, that's fine. Try not to use too much gain, but you'll need enough so that you can get your pinch harmonics and your natural harmonics. Now, and also if you've got humbuckers, try them in split coil mode, as in like if you've got a coil cut switch that turns your humbucker into a single coil, try that as well. Anyway, so I go from my guitar into an actual analog chorus pedal, and what I'll try and do is I'll try and demonstrate what that sounds like off. So this is what it sounds like. This is what it sounds like off. And this is what happens when I turn this analog pedal on. It's just an MXR analog chorus pedal. It kind of gives you that some of those 80s, 90s. Sorry, I had to fix my computer. Kind of gives you that layered multi-chorus thing that you might have got from like a TC rack unit or something like that. So this is chorus before any drive pedals or anything like that, and it just gives you a different vibe. It just helps you get like this really nice textured sort of extra random warbliness, which I kind of like for that early 80s tone. Here is it off again. So that's just the chorus you're hearing from the Spark app. And here is with pedal again. So I like it with it on. Okay, so from there I'm going into, funny enough, an Echoplex boost pedal. Set just above unity gain and in the slightly darker mode, not the brighter mode. This one that I've got is from Clinch FX. It's called an EP Plus. Great pedal. I've found this pedal is great before preamps, before overdrives, after overdrives, even after a preamp in an effects loop. So you can use it as a volume boost, and it adds some grit and some warmth and some tone. This one here has two voicings. It's got a bright and a sort of warm up one. I think one's based on the Echoplex 2 and the other one's based on the Echoplex 3. I use them both modes for different things. I use it in the bright mode after a dark sounding preamp. I use it in the warm mode after a bright sounding preamp. There's all sorts of applications, really good. And you just get that extra little thickness and attitude out of your guitar. I think it just helps. And so from there, I'm going into my Spark amp. This one here happens just to be the Spark Mini. In the app, you'll notice I've got, when you actually have a look at it, I've got my rat pedal. The rat pedal's set on full volume. Filtering is a little bit on the warmer side rather than the trebly side, because I was getting a little bit too much treble out of the guitar. I just wanted to dial that out a little bit. Anyway, the distortion's almost halfway. And then we go into the SLO amp. The SLO amp is set on around about half gain, because again, if you make that too high, it starts to get a bit sludgy, a bit too muddy. The bass is all the way down on the amp. You just don't need it. And the middle is about halfway. The treble on this amp is all the way down, mainly because I find the treble on the SLO amp model on this particular emulation adds a little bit too much harshness. It's fine when you're doing some chugging and some brutal metal and stuff like that, but it's not the kind of that doesn't make for really smooth lead soloing. So that's all the way down. My master volume on the amp is all the way up. So then we go into the chorus pedal. The chorus pedal is set on about mix half, and you can just tweak it to taste. If you haven't got your own chorus pedal to stick in front of your Spark amp to experiment with to get that, you know, kind of try chorus sound, you can mess around with your own mix level and all that sort of stuff in the chorus. I'm going to the echo tape delay to give me a bit more ambience, and then I go into a chamber reverb set quite predominant. When you listen to the original recording, you kind of understand why. It's kind of sounds like Brett's playing in a kind of hall, for want of a better word. And it just sounds really spacious and ambient, but still maintaining clarity. Fantastic sound. I love the sound of that solo. Anyway, so that pretty much explains the sound. So from the headphone out of my Spark amp, I'm going into my mixer, and the only thing I'm doing there is obviously I'm going left and right, into my interface. The only thing I'm doing is I'm putting a high cut filter. So I'm basically filtering out any frequencies below 75 hertz. And that just, again, helps get rid of any unwanted low frequencies, helps the solo kind of jump out a bit more. Anyway. I've probably waffled on a bit too much, or enough. Anyway, hope you enjoyed the video. If you happen to nail the solo, I'd love to hear it. Why not post it, link me, shoot me a hoy, whatever, and I'll give it a look. And who knows? Maybe even Brett will see it. He saw mine and was kind enough to comment. It was like the highlight of my year, I think, having Brett comment on my solo. I was fortunate enough to meet him twice, actually. I've seen him three times, and met him briefly twice. One of them was at a masterclass here in Hobart, and managed to have a few words with him. And super nice chap, easy to talk to, and phenomenal guitarist. And if you haven't checked him out, you should. Everything that he's done, in my opinion, is magic. From his solo work to his collaborative stuff with TJ Helmrich, it's all fantastic. You should just check out his work. And it's kind of a bit depressing, really, because you want to be able to play like that, but without developing his hybrid technique, you kind of got Buckley's. And like I said, he spent a lifetime honing that skill. And unless you do the same, you're probably not going to get there, unless you kind of do it in a roundabout sort of way and develop your own skill, your own approach to doing it. But anyway, again, I digress. So I hope you enjoyed the video. Give me a shout out if you do a cover of it. I'd be interested to see it. And if you've got any other questions, shoot me a hoy. And if anyone wants to see a breakdown of another solo that I've done, or a section of a solo, shoot me a hoy. I'll see if I can find the time to do it for you. Until then, ciao for now.